Today on Total Maine, multiple failures. Findings from the Army's investigation into the handling of concerns about the eventual Lewiston shooter. The new insight from those records. And unanimous support. The chair of the Maine Democratic Party joins us in studio to talk about Kamala Harris and her run for the White House. Plus, Aid investigates homeless seniors, the new data, and one woman's personal story of surviving in the Maine woods. Hello, and thank you for joining us on Total Maine here on this final Sunday in July. I'm Terry Stackhouse. This past week, the U.S. Army Reserve released its report into Lewiston shooter Robert Card, and among its findings, what the Reserve calls multiple communication failures between civilian and military hospitals and the Army Reserve's chain of command. At the time of October's shooting, Sergeant First Class Card was not in a duty status and not under direct control of the U.S. Army. A week after the shooting, Lieutenant General Jody Daniels ordered an investigation into Card's conduct and his suicide. The report says the Army considered taking Card's personal weapons away, but felt that that would be best left to local law enforcement. John Krisos of Maine's Total Coverage spoke exclusively with the Lieutenant General just hours before this report was released.
We're looking at making sure that all of our commanders at all echelons understand what authorities they do and don't have in terms of, you know, we can't compel soldiers to give up their private weapons, but we have the ability to have an exception to policy to store them if we can convince them to give them to us. We don't have the authority to do lots of different things. We do have the authority to, as commanders, request access to medical records. Given particular questions of a particular person for a particular reason, we can make those requests. And making sure that our commanders understand what those left and right limits are and how they can get those exceptions.
Should the Army and the military have that authority to take away weapons if they believe that somebody is a danger to either himself or self or the community?
I think it's the right move to pass that over to local law enforcement because they're not under our jurisdiction, but they are under civilian jurisdiction. And to pass the information that we are concerned about health, welfare, safety over to those folks and let them make that call.
The Army's investigation reveals serious internal failures, but it also continues to place some of the blame on local law enforcement. Saginaw County Sheriff's Deputy Aaron Schofield has long fallen under scrutiny for failing to remove Robert Card's guns during two attempted welfare checks in the weeks leading up to the Lewiston shootings. Nora Hogan sat down with Schofield to get his reaction to this report.
It's sad. The whole report is sad, the way everything that went down, all the people that are affected. What was done, what could have been done, what was withheld is probably the most shocking part of it for me. There's a lot of information that was not disclosed to us. Had one, you know, like I'd said in other interviews, had one piece of the puzzle just been moved a little bit, that could have changed the whole way of the chain of events unfolded, and that's. It's sad. I, you know, it was never communicated to me that he was weapons restricted with the military, and that's what we found out. You know, through not only through the report, but through additional testimony from members of the Army.
And did the Army interview you in their process of this investigation?
They did not, and that was one of the things that I, you know, going through their synopsis, their six-page synopsis that they sent out. They talked about how they attempted to interview several people, and those people, including law enforcement, declined to interact with the Army. I absolutely would have. I have nothing to hide. I was happy to talk to them. I've answered every question from the commission and from members of the media. All the Army had to do was approach me, and I absolutely would have talked to them. So for them to say that they reached out to law enforcement directly involved, all law enforcement directly involved, is not accurate.
And this report, it does say that local law enforcement, including the Saginaw County Sheriff's Office, could have done more to restrict Card's weapons, but they do take ownership over some pretty serious mistakes that they made. Do you feel that that at all exonerates local law enforcement by their ownership of their mistakes?
To a certain degree, it does. But the fact that you've got military people investigating in it and saying things that law enforcement should have done were outside the legal scope of the law. To say that, you know, we as law enforcement officers, I mean, CIT training, crisis intervention training, is regularly taught to a wide variety of law enforcement officers throughout the state, including myself, and it's constant de-escalation, de-escalation, de-escalation. And when you look at some of the case law that's involved, Caniglia v. Strom, we're not allowed to create an exigent circumstance. We're not allowed to violate people's Fourth Amendment rights and force an interaction with someone who does not want to interact with us. Having doing something like that, you then set yourself up for legal problems.
Nora Hogan with that interview for us. The Inspector General's overview of the investigation found that the reserve was unable to interview several key witnesses, including Maine law enforcement personnel, because they didn't have the legal authority to compel them to talk. Investigates reached out for clarification and found that the Army did not ask any Saginaw County Sheriff's deputies or Maine State Police troopers for interviews. They say that they received police reports, which they claim were sufficient. Since the report's release, victims' families and survivors are asking for another investigation. In a letter sent to Maine's congressional delegation, attorneys for the families are calling on the Defense Department's Inspector General to investigate further. The requests ask the IG to look into whether the warning signs and system failures found by the investigation could have spread to other branches of the military. And remember, this was the U.S. Army Reserve's report. The report from the Independent Commission here in Maine investigating October's shooting is expected sometime this summer. Our total coverage on the investigations into the deadliest mass shooting in Maine's history continues on WMTW.com and inside Maine's Total Coverage app. There you can read the Army's report for yourself and learn more about the 18 people killed. With push notifications turned on, we'll be sure to send you the Independent Commission's report, expected to be released this summer, as soon as it becomes available to us. The race for the White House turned upside down over the last week. After announcing that he will not seek a second term, President Biden endorsing Vice President Kamala Harris in her bid for the White House. In the hours that followed, Harris quickly received the support of numerous leading Democrats, and millions of dollars in donations poured in. On Monday night, Maine's 32 Democratic delegates met virtually, and among those present, they voted unanimously to support the vice president. Ahead of next month's Democratic National Convention in Chicago, we're joined in studio to discuss all of this with the chair of the Maine Democratic Party, Bev Uhlenhaek. We're just weeks away now from the Democratic National Convention. Kamala Harris is at this point really the presumptive nominee among political observers, and I think most people who've been paying attention to the news cycle. Bev Uhlenhaek is the chair of the Maine Democratic Party. It's so nice to see you again. We do appreciate you coming in here.
It's great to be here.
So the Maine delegation met on Monday night, and the decision was unanimous to back Kamala Harris. I saw that New Hampshire's delegation took similar action 24 hours before. How did this happen so fast? And you know, was there any question of whether we should have an open convention or consider other candidates?
I think it's important for folks to remember as they're talking about how fast this goes, is that we've vetted Kamala Harris over the last 3.5 years. When we elected the Biden-Harris ticket in 2020, we had already made the decision that if something happens to President Biden, she's qualified on day one to take the job. And so, it may seem fast, but we've been paying attention for a very long time.
How do you think the vice president is going to perform in Maine's 2nd District? We know, of course, in Congressional District 1, the Portland area tends to lean liberal, to say the least, but it could be a toss-up in CD2, which has gone for Trump the last two cycles.
It has gone for Trump in the last two cycles, and CD2 is a different world. And I've lived there for almost 3 decades, so I get it. I think she has a chance. It's going to be a tough race. We're going to work really hard. I think there are a lot of things about Kamala Harris that people have to latch on to that they'll really like when they learn more about her.
Speaking of CD2, Congressman Jared Golden has not yet offered his endorsement to the vice president. He had that op-ed in the Bangor Daily News, which generated a lot of headlines. At that point, it was a Biden-Trump race, but he said that Trump was going to win in November. What do you make of that? Is that an acceptable statement within the Maine Democratic Party?
So I think it's important to remember that we're a big tent and that we share values, but we might think about different ways on how to get to accomplish those values. Congressman Golden is incredibly thoughtful, and he'll think through this. He rarely comes out immediately with a snap decision. he may or may not endorse, but that's going to be his choice.
So, I mean, it's really the cost of doing business. Is that how you see it in CD2, where you want to maintain that seat for Democrats?
It's not about the cost of doing business. It's about him representing his district. His district is not as liberal as CD1, and he pays attention to his voters, and I think that that's very appropriate.
When it comes to the vice president's policy positions, what do you think is going to resonate the most with Maine voters who may be on the middle and may not have selected a candidate in this race yet?
There's a lot of talk about that middle, and I think that people forget that the middle has a lot of the same values that we do on the left, and a lot of that revolves around rights, around making sure that people have the right to choose, that they can control their own bodies. I think that there's a lot there in the middle too, that those folks are gonna latch on to some of her stances around her past as a prosecutor. That has sometimes frustrated the far left. That's okay. Again, we're a big tent party. We share the same values. Sometimes we think there are different ways to get to those goals.
Campaigning priorities, the Midwest, the Rust Belt, but do you think that we see Vice President Harris in Maine in the lead up to November?
I sure hope so. We'd love to have her here. We'd love to have her showing what she's got right here in Maine.
Still ahead on Total Maine, opening up the ocean to more surfers. Jacob Murphy takes us to York to hang 10 with Equipped for Surfing. First, though, the number of Maine seniors who are experiencing homelessness is on the rise next. We're going to hear one woman's personal experience, what she's going through now, what some groups are doing to try and address the issue. That's when Total Maine returns. A Special 8 Investigates report today on the rising number of homeless seniors in Maine. A federal report released last year found that out of 650,000 people experiencing homelessness, more than 100,000 of them were over the age of 55. In Maine, experts recognize this is a growing problem, but also admit it's not a lot of solid data. Here's what we do have, though. We asked Maine Housing for records going back to 2010, and look at this trend line. There's a spike in homelessness for Mainers over 55 coming out of the pandemic. And important to note here, this only reflects data from shelters that receive taxpayer funding. It's a problem linked in large part to the cost of housing.
And I'd like to know when it's my time to go, at least I had a home, a real home.
Carla Hussey works full-time at a big box store and still lives here, a small damaged camper in the woods of rural York County. But it's a step up from the car that she was sleeping in before.
Believe it or not, a camper can be rough, but with all my health issues, a camper is way better than living in your car.
Or sleeping outside.
Or sleeping outside.
Yeah. Can you show us the camper?
Yes, I would love to.
Too small for a bed, Hussey sleeps on a table.
I have to get up at 2, and I'm at work at 3:45 in the morning.
This comes a few years after losing her longtime home, a small apartment over a garage, after the town notified the landlord that the unit was unfit to rent. Last December, her husband died. She has atrial fibrillation, a heart condition, and worries that the situation is making her health worse.
And this is the group who, if I tell you they're 52 years of age chronologically, you can probably assume that their biological health is at least 10 to 20 years beyond that. So they may be 52, but they have the bodies of 62 to 72 year olds.
Dr. Leonard Kay is the director of the UMaine Center on Aging. Seniors, he says, are the least studied group of people experiencing homelessness.
These are individuals who are stoic, have a stiff upper lip mentality, who resist asking for help, delay doing that until a crisis emerges.
Dr. Katie Spencer-White is the CEO for Mid-Maine Homeless Shelter and Services in Waterville.
Almost half of our population is over 55, and sadly, it's very common for us to have a handful or two of people who are over the age of 80.
The trend is discouraging, but she sees solutions and thinks that housing should be looked at through a public health lens. Spencer would like to see Maine adopt the use of what's called a Section 1115 Medicaid waiver.
Because we're not allowed to do it right now, to target some of those healthcare dollars towards key health-related social needs like housing.
I just would like to hear running water in a toilet and be able to take a shower. And you know that annoying sound the faucet makes when it drips on you, I miss that.
Hussey is hopeful that she will be granted some form of housing support that will be accepted by a landlord. Hussey feels like her life depends on it.
It is gonna be a life-threatening or saving moment for me.
Our thanks to Carla for sharing her story. And some more numbers for you. Maine housing data shows that last year, 740 Mainers 55 and up were homeless. That's an increase of nearly 200 over the previous year. To make sure everyone is able to get out and moving, the Equipped for Living Foundation supports people with special needs with adaptive sports equipment and classes. Jacob Murphy is taking us to Long Sands Beach in York to sit in on one of their surfing sessions.
Popping up is a basic skill you learn in surfing camp, but for some, it's not always physically possible, and that's where adaptive equipment comes in.
On warm summer days at Long Sands Beach in York, it's not unusual to see people taking out their surfboards to catch some waves. Something Tara Now, the founder of Equipped for Living, is hoping to bring for everyone.
I've had the pleasure of being around individuals with special needs my entire life. And I noticed over the years that as they became adults, there were less funding for them to get equipment and therapeutic things that were not covered by insurance.
In order to facilitate that, she created the Equipped for Surfing program. It provides lessons and adaptive equipment that can be used by students with different mobility levels.
We have a special chair and a harness that we strap on top of a large board. And then we have several individuals that are around the board. So we'll pick it up, carry it out to the water. And we are with that individual the entire time as they are able to catch a wave.
The first time that I came here, I was actually on the board with 15, 20, I don't know, volunteers. I felt like Cleopatra being guided, and you know, it was just incredible.
Kyle Spanik has been with the program for 4 years, and she's now able to balance on her own and isn't afraid to wipe out.
I fell like everybody else and did some really great clean falls. Falling's always been one of my strengths.
The classes, including use of equipment, is all provided for free. That also means it's completely run by volunteers. There was more than a dozen people ready to go, all bringing their own expertise or just some extra hands.
It's wonderful being there to help them and like support them and like going through that journey with them.
It's so fun to help people learn how to do it because it's literally the most coolest thing when you get up on the board, or literally if you're just floating on board, it's so fun.
It's not limited to physical disabilities, and they all have found their own unique ways of shredding waves.
How long have you been surfing for?
3 years.
How far do you think you've come with surfing?
I can kneel, but today I'm going to try to stand.
And most importantly, they're all totally stoked to be out on the water.
I love the water going over my head. I love it.
And do you hope to be surfing for a long time?
Yes. Oh yeah.
Equipped for Surfing's always looking for volunteers. I'm gonna get out there myself, but if you're interested in helping out, their next event is August 8th. In hometown York, I'm Jacob Murphy for Maine's Total Coverage.
A great story and awesome volunteers. So this is a video that we're still talking about. We saw it over the last week. It was taken just off the coast of Portsmouth, New Hampshire. You see a whale jumping out of the water and then crashing into a fishing boat. Ross Ketchke takes us to Rye, New Hampshire, and talks with the two fishermen who fell off that boat.
A day on the water taking an unbelievable turn. Two fishermen off the coast of Portsmouth tossed overboard by one of the largest creatures in the ocean.
People are saying, oh, it was like 3 seconds. How did you act that fast? But it was almost like slow motion, like a movie.
Rylan Kenny and Greg Piquette say they were fishing for stripers early this morning. They spotted that whale feeding and tried to keep their distance, but by the time it was breaching over their boat, it was too late.
He disappeared for a few minutes, and then the next thing we know, he just popped right up on our transom. You know, his mouth was open. He was just looking looking to feed.
Later in the day, they were able to tow the boat back into shore, and incredibly, there's not that much damage. There are some cracks here in the top of the fiberglass of the outboard engine, but all things considered, it could have been a lot worse.
I think I was more scared an hour after than I was at the time.
The two were pulled out of the water by brothers Colin and Wyatt Yeager, who were also fishing nearby and caught the whale on cell phone video.
I had my fishing rod right here and phone in my hand, and I saw it go up.
I saw it come up, and I was just like, oh, it's gonna hit the boat.
They just wanted to get us out of the water because I think they were, you know, nearly as shocked as we were.
The Portsmouth-based Blue Ocean Society for Marine Conservation identified the whale as a humpback. Whales have been spotted around Portsmouth Harbor recently, like this one seen by a U local member just a few days ago near the Naval Shipyard. The Coast Guard says the humpback doesn't appear to have been hurt after landing on the boat. Paquette says it's an important reminder to be prepared for anything while out on the water.
I'd absolutely wear your life jacket. And the reason, like, you don't know what's going to happen. I mean, I certainly couldn't predict we're going to get capsized by a whale today.
In Elliott, Ross Ketchke, Maine's Total Coverage.
That'd be tough to predict if you have some work to do around the house. There's a group at Oxford Hills that's ready to help. Talia Clark introduces us to the Mission Men when Total Maine returns. On this Sunday, you might have a long honey-do list of chores you got to take care of around the house, trying to put a dent in those. We've all been there. If you need some backup, though, there's a group of friends using their combined talents to build up their community. Talia Clark takes us to Hebron and introduces us to the Oxford Hills Mission Men.
It all started at the breakfast table. A group of men from six different churches who meet weekly at a local restaurant decided to put their skills together. And that's how they came up with the Oxford Hills Mission Men, providing free labor for local projects.
Chester's been a carpenter forever. He's a bookkeeper. He's a warehouse manager. He worked in construction for a long time. And we've got everything in our group, everything. We've done a deck. We've done three or four set of stairs. And we help rebuild the one-room schoolhouse down in Oxford, which we have to go back to sometime this year.
One of the latest projects was at the nonprofit Lifehouse Maine that gives pregnant mothers in need a place to stay. The Oxford Hills Mission Men built a ramp that now makes the building ADA compliant.
People get pregnant, and if they can't access our home, then we can't help them, right? So having that bonus piece, it's like the icing on a cake, really. It's that extra piece that we needed.
It really lets you know that you're not alone.
Their mission is simple. Use their God-given talents to get the job done. If you'd like to donate to their future projects, you can make that out to the Oxford Hills Mission Men and send it to either the First Congregational Church in South Paris or the Advent Christian Church in Oxford.
It's just a natural thing for all of us to want to help others, and we can. Thank God we can.
Reporting in Hebron, I'm Talia Clark for Maine's Total Coverage.
Neighbors helping neighbors, you love to see it. It's going to do it for this week's edition of Total Maine. I'm Terry Stackhouse. Thank you so much for being here. Going to leave you with some incredible scenes of nature from the old Dearborn Farm in Oakland, courtesy of Total Maine video journalist Kevin Fowler. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. We'll see you right back here next Sunday for Total Maine.